Good morning and welcome to BIF. We are so glad that you are here this morning. My name is Neil Newhoff. I'm one of the elders here at BIF. Baku International Fellowship is a multi-denominational, multinational family growing in a loving relationship with Jesus Christ and with each other here at BIF. It is always all about Jesus. Last week, we had the opportunity to say goodbye to some people. Some will be coming back and some will not. Thank you guys for everything that you've done here in our community. Pastor Tim sent out an email this week, and in it, it said that our Benevolence Fund could use your support. We've missed a number of opportunities for giving to that fund already this year. And so this month, on the 12th, 13th, 16th, and 17th, all of the contributions that come through the Red Million machines will go directly to the Benevolence Fund. So if that's something you're interested in, get out there, stick that money in the machine, and it will go directly to the Benevolence Fund. If you need more details on how to do that, they are all in the email that Pastor Tim sent out. So pull that up and read it. Psalm 113 says, "Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore, from the rising of the sun to its setting. The name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory is above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, who is seated on high, who looks far down on the heavens and the earth?" This is our God, who is far above anything that's happening on earth or in the heavens. This is our God that we put our trust in. This is the Jesus Christ that it's always all about. Let me pray for us as we head into worship. Father, thank you so much for all that you have done for us. Jesus, thank you that you are worthy of our praise. We thank you that you are worthy of our thanksgiving. To you be all glory and honor. Amen.
Gonna let me down. In your promises, my confidence. is your faithfulness, and we will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. Faithful you are. Faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are. And all your promises are yes and amen. And all your promises are yes and amen.
Glorious, matchless in every way, wonderful. Would you bow your head as I lead us in a word of prayer? Oh, very good, faithful, and loving God, we come before you. We fall down before you in worship and praise and adoration because you are present with us. You're not down at the Hyatt waiting for us to show up. Father, you are with us wherever we are, in our bedrooms or in our living rooms. Wherever we are, wherever your people are, there you are in the midst. So God, I pray that you would make your presence known, that you, Lord, would make it very real to each person, and that, Father, you would minister to hearts and minds and lives. We're crying out to you from a world that is in chaos, a world that has gone totally out of our control, and so we need to come into your presence where we know that you are not just in control, but that you are in loving and good and faithful control. God, teach us about your faithfulness. Teach us today about the greatness of your favor and grace and love. Lord, let it sink down deep into our souls. We, Lord, might be people who proclaim hope in the midst of darkness. That, Lord, in the midst of our discomfort, we find, Lord, the God of all comfort, the God of all strength, the God of all love, surrounding and keeping and showing us your faithfulness moment by moment. We dedicate these moments to you. We come before you and we say, we're yours. Our heart is yours, Lord. Take it and fill it, Lord, with your presence. For your glory and for your honor, we pray. And God's people said, amen. Hey, I want to welcome you to a new series of messages out of the book of Jonah. Jonah, a book that oftentimes we look at and we say, well, it's about Jonah and a big fish. But I hope over these six sessions that we'll be able to see that God's purpose and what he had in mind was to talk about his own goodness, his own faithfulness, his character, the greatness, the grandeur of our awesome God. I saw that grandeur a few years ago. July 1st of this year will be 3 years since my daughter Lindsay and her husband Joseph were married back in Pennsylvania. Lindsay wanted to have an outdoor wedding, and so we rented a farm basically for it. It was a structure that had no walls on it at all. The reception was going to be just in this big shed. The wedding itself was going to be in a little valley, a little natural amphitheater where we would have about 120 guests that would gather and watch my daughter and son-in-law exchange vows for their marriage together. We worked for months leading up to that. I remember one particular Thursday. It was a Friday morning. It was my day off, and we had found out about a certain kind of lantern that was on sale at one particular store in Northeast Ohio, Mark's. And so I spent the whole day driving all over Northeast Ohio in a driving snowstorm buying these little lanterns for the wedding. Well, the day came, and the week before it was not good because we were looking forward to this day for months, but yet the week ahead of it was filled with rain. Every day was a prediction of rain. Oh, and it got worse and worse through the week. The chances of rain got higher and higher until you hit Saturday, the day of the wedding, it was 100%. But we kept going through that week, trusting and believing that it would end up being a nice day. Well, so that Saturday morning came. The clouds were incredibly dark. It hadn't started raining yet. My father-in-law and I and Danita drove up to the farm where the wedding was to be held, and as we were driving in, it started to rain. And about 9:30, the heavens just opened up. It just poured, deluge of rain. And for 45 minutes, all we saw was rain. Rain, rain, rain. Now, we had prepared to some degree. We had bought some umbrellas to try to help get people from the car into the shed where the wedding would be. And we bought some tarps to put over the walls so that we'd have at least some kind of plastic wall. But it was coming down so hard, and the water was coming into the shed where we were to have this gathering. And my father-in-law and I were in there squeezing out the rain as it came down, and just kept coming and coming. I looked down into that beautiful amphitheater where we were to have the wedding, and it was just filled with water. I'm saying, God, what are you doing? This is supposed to be a precious day. Where's your goodness? Where's your faithfulness? Where's the blessings of being your child, where you stopped the rain and had the beautiful day? It was hard. I was going through a little bit of a faith crisis at that point. My father-in-law and wife, Danita, they drove away. And there I was in the midst of this downpour, and I'm crying out to God, what is going on? I kind of hesitated to tell that story, just because I know that there are at least four couples or four women on our church who are looking forward to a wedding. And COVID-19 has it's kind of made a difference in our plans. And we're not too sure. Things are out of control. What do we do when life doesn't go as planned? When things go out of our control and no longer are they happening as we thought they should happen. It's not just weather that does that. It's not just COVID-19 global pandemics that make that difference. What about the couple who buys a home? They have the closing, and a few days later, the husband goes into the office and they call him in and they say, I'm sorry, we're going to have to lay you off. Wait a minute, I just bought a house. God, what are you doing? There's a student who is so sure that God wants them to go to a certain school. They applied for scholarships. It's way too expensive for their family. They've applied for all the loans and scholarships they can get, but they find out that no, the loan has been denied. The scholarship will not come through. There's the expectant mother who loses the baby. And then on the other side, there is the empty nest couple who are looking forward to retirement and traveling and seeing the world. And they get a surprise. Where is God? God, what are you doing? Those things that we admit that are out of our control. Those things that happen in our lives, and we admit they're out of our control, but we look to God and we say, God, surely you have control of this. Why aren't you doing something? I didn't wrestle with what to preach about this summer. I really came upon preaching upon Jonah a few months ago. I thought that it would be later in the summer after we returned from a little time of vacation and holiday in the United States. And as it is, I'm going to be here. And I thought, well, let's just start this series now. I love this series. When God put it on my heart to preach this series a few years ago, I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to do it because I didn't like the idea of getting up and telling a bunch of people who were really trying hard to follow God and obey God, who were in some difficult circumstances, some of them, to say to them, well, look, you know, God is telling you to do something, and if you don't do it, you're going to get eaten up by a fish. That's just not fair. But God worked in my heart through my studies and through a book that someone had given me that says, you know, the purpose of Jonah is not to make people feel guilty and scared that they're going to be eaten by a fish. The purpose of Jonah is to show the greatness of God. You know, in fact, from Genesis to Revelation, it's all about the greatness of God. God is the main character in every scene of the Bible. Everybody else is just a supporting cast. They're there to support God telling us who he is and what he's all about and the depth of his love and grace and mercy and power and brilliance. The entire account of Jonah is all about the grandeur of God, His grace, His power, His justice, His love. And it's all about how He worked in Jonah's life and how He wants to work in your life and my life today. It's the purpose of it is to enlarge our understanding of who God is and what He wants to do. We want to look at this and we want to see how God worked in Jonah's life to show Jonah, the sailors, the Ninevites, all of them, to show them how He wanted to be involved in their lives. The grandeur of God. The grandeur of God is seen in life's interruptions. You see, it's not interruptions so much as it is God's intervention to show us His glory and power. Let's just begin by looking at Jonah chapter 1, and I'm just going to read the first three verses for today. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, "Go to that great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. And after paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. The first phrase that is used here is really important. The word of the Lord came to Jonah. Now here's the point. That God speaks to us at all is a miracle. You know, the way people look at the book of Jonah oftentimes is they get critical because, well, how could a man ever be eaten by a fish and spend 3 days in its belly and still survive? And they can't understand that miracle, and they get fixated upon that miracle. And all that does really is it takes our attention away from what God would have us to focus on as the real miracle. That a great, awesome, holy God actually speaks to us. He doesn't really need us, but He does want us. This great God whom we sing of, God of wonders beyond our galaxy, You're holy, You are holy. This God, this awesome, great, powerful God wants to speak to us. And that's a miracle. But too often we've made God into our own image. We've made God so approachable that we have lost the wonder that He speaks to us. There are two words in the original language that are both translated the word of the Lord. The first one has to do with instructions to someone. The word of the Lord came to Jonah. The other kind is when God tells us to tell somebody else something. In other words, tell someone else these words. The word of the Lord to someone. Well, the word that came to Jonah that day with an instruction to Jonah. He was used to the other kind. He was a prophet. And so he heard from the Lord regularly, evidently, that the messages that God would have for other people. And he was the spokesperson then for God. But here God is directly speaking to him. Here's why we need to be careful about that. It's very easy to sit back and listen to a sermon or read a book or listen to a tape and say, oh, I sure do hope Scott is listening to this. Or, oh, that's a great verse. I got to send that to Ethel. I'll do it anonymously so she doesn't feel it's from me. But she needs to hear this. You ever thought that? Jonah's way of thinking was what this word was for someone else. But here it was a word for him. There has to be this attitude in us that it's for me. How long has it been since God talked to you? What is God speaking to you about? Is there some attitude in your heart that He wants to change? Is there a sin that He wants to address? Maybe He has put a challenge before you, something that is stretching you, like it stretched Jonah. God speaks to us. You might ask, well, how does he speak to us, Pastor? One of the ways that we try to get around this was, I really don't know how God speaks to us. I can give you very quickly, this could be a whole series itself, but very quickly, the first and primary way is through his word. God's written word is the standard by which we measure all other ways that God communicates to us. It is the filter through which, it's the way we understand all the other ways that God speaks to us. Nothing should contradict what God's word says to us. The second way that God oftentimes speaks to us is through other people. Not necessarily the preacher or the prophet. Sometimes it's the people closest to us. And oftentimes it's our spouse. I've even had my children speak to me, and I realize this is God trying to speak into my life. The third way is through circumstances and situations that we find in our lives. Experiences that scream to us, God trying to get our attention. I love the verse in John chapter 10, verse 27. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. Do you hear God's voice? Do you know God's voice? Do you recognize God's voice when he is speaking to you? Maybe this series is all about you crying out to God, God, I need to hear you. I need to hear you speak deeply to my soul. I need to speak into my life to give me direction and purpose and meaning. God spoke into Jonah's life, and he wants to speak into yours. I think there are a couple of things that this passage of Scripture, these three verses, these short three verses, talk to us about how God is working his interventions into our lives and what we're supposed to glean from those. First of all, God often calls us out of our comfort zones. He said to Jonah, arise, go to that great city of Nineveh and preach against it. Now, we would think any prophet would hear those words and be excited about going out and proclaiming God's word to other people. But Nineveh was enemy number one for Israel. They hated the Ninevites. The Ninevites had oppressed them. The Ninevites were ungodly, very, very pagan people. The Ninevites, they hated Israel as much as Israel hated the Ninevites. It's a passage in 2 Kings chapter 14 that tells us a little bit about Jonah and his ministry that he had there in Israel. The scripture reads like this from 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 23-27. Jeroboam II, the son of Jehoash, began to rule over Israel in the 15th year of King Amaziah's reign in Judah. Jeroboam reigned in Samaria 41 years. He did what was evil in the Lord's sight. He refused to turn from the sins that Jeroboam, son of Nebat, had led Israel to commit. Jeroboam II recovered the territories of Israel between Lebo Hamath and the Dead Sea, just as the Lord, the God of Israel, listen to this, just as the Lord, the God of Israel, had promised through Jonah, the son of Amati, the prophet from Gath-Hefner. For the Lord saw the bitter suffering of everyone in Israel, and that there was no one in Israel, slave, free, to help them. And because the Lord had not said that he would blot out the name of Israel completely, he used Jeroboam II, the son of Joash, to save them. It's really remarkable, Jonah's ministry there. I mean, he had a great ministry, a prophecy there. He prophesied things, and they came true. And that made the value of his words go way up. He was a prophet with high stocks. People were looking to him, because his prophecies had succeeded, and they were beneficial to the country. He also was pretty comfortable. Wasn't a bad gig that he had going. There's very little conflict going on. What was great for Jonah is Jonah was never told to go confront Jeroboam. It was a nice job that he had. But he's being stretched. He's being called to go out of his comfort zone. What happens with you when you are called out of your comfort zone? When things are out of our control, all of a sudden we don't have control over our situations. It's been kind of a thing where we have been forced out of our comfort zones. Something like a global pandemic, maybe. At other times, God is calling us. He's leading us in our lives out of comfort into areas of discomfort. Oftentimes we'll say, well, I'm just not gifted this way. That's just who I am. I'm just the way I am. That's the way it is. And I love the one that says, I just don't feel called into that kind of ministry. You see, God calls us into areas of discomfort because it's only when we're desperately dependent upon God that we are finally able to see Him do the miraculous in and around us. You see, it's a thing where if I can do it, it ain't a miracle. If you can do it, it ain't a miracle. It's only when we are in a situation that is out of our control, that is totally dependent upon God, that we see miracles happen around us. So where is your comfort zone? Where is your discomfort zone? Where is God stretching you today? Is it in this global pandemic and the tension, the fear, the anxiety that you feel? Where is He trying to expand you? Where is He trying to expand you? And this might be the better way to ask this whole question. Where is He trying to expand your understanding of how great He is? You see, it's not just to make you just comfortable. It's to make you rely and depend upon Him more. God is speaking to you. He's speaking to you through circumstances or through the situations you're facing. And He's saying, I want to show you how great and awesome I am. The second thing that I think we need to realize out of these few verses is that God often sends us into hopeless situations. When He speaks to us, when He calls us, He takes us into places that are literally hopeless. God described the Ninevites this way. Its wickedness has come up against me. The New Living Translation translates it this way. I see how wicked the people are. Nineveh was a totally hopeless people. It was a situation that went beyond any comprehension of how God could work or use that situation. It would be just like God calling some of us to go into ISIS, to go to ISIS, wherever they are, and declare the word of the Lord to them. It would be suicide. Nuts. God's not going to save them. In Jonah's mind and the minds of the Israelites, God would never want to have anything to do with Ninevites. They were hopelessly evil. As I studied this and thought about it, I began wondering, well, who are the hopeless people in my life? And at first I thought, well, there couldn't be that many. I think that I believe God can work in almost any life. See the word there? Almost. I began thinking through it. And I started categorizing people. Well, who are the people in my life where I think they will never, ever change? Or who are the people that I would say, I can't see them ever coming to faith in Christ? I began to find there were lots more people there than I care to admit. What about you? What about you? Who are the people who are hopeless in your life? Where is your Nineveh? Who is your Nineveh? For whom would you say, oh, it's going to take a miracle for them to change. It's going to take a miracle for them to come to Christ. My friends, that's the Nineveh in your life. Maybe it's more personal than just people out there. Maybe it's something within you. Maybe it's a marriage that is crumbling today. A friendship that's gone bad. Somebody that you were close to, but there's been something that came between you and you can't reconcile it. You say it's a hopelessly lost friendship. Maybe it's an addiction you can't shake. A sin that has gripped your soul. You think, I'll never get rid of this. Maybe it's a rebellious son or daughter. You think they're just never going to come back to God. We don't like going out of our comfort zones, do we? Sometimes God forces us into that discomfort zone. That discomfort zone where He is saying, let me show you the greatness of my power, the greatness of my love, the draw that I have on people's hearts and lives. You see, it's in the most discomfortable areas of life. It's in the most hopeless situation that God's light, His hope, His comfort shines the brightest. You see, there is something very important that we need to glean from this. That hopeless situations accentuate, they put the focus on the brilliance of God's hope in our lives. When I was getting ready to propose to Danita, I went down into New York City. I was living outside of New York City, went down into the city and met a Jewish jeweler who had sold his business, but he continued to deal in diamonds and rings out of his apartment. He had sold thousands of rings to NIAC college students like myself. And I went to his apartment and sat down at his dining room table, and he went back to his bedroom, and I heard him clicking around on some things, and finally he came out. He rolled out this black velvet piece of cloth, and then he took this little pouch and dumped out diamonds. The diamonds just sparkled against the black velvet. And you see, what God was doing was He was taking Jonah into the darkest of places, the most hopeless situations that Jonah could ever think of. And God was saying, look, I have the power to overcome any hopeless situation. The brilliance of God's hope for our world is found in Him. It's seen best in the hopelessness of the world. The more hopeless the world gets, the brighter God's hope is. I think about that when I think back to the United States right now, and I see the news reports and read the reports about the turmoil and chaos having to do with racial tensions and injustices. And it looks totally hopeless. How's this going to get resolved? But I really believe in a God who will do the miraculous, even there. A God who is filled with hope, a God of hope, described as a part of His character is hope. I love the verse in Romans chapter 15, verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, do you know that God's will is for you to overflow with hope? Overflow so that the people all around you experience the hope of God because of the storehouse of hope in you. You see, the only way that will happen is when He takes us to discomforting places, when He takes us to hopeless situations, and we see the power of God at work. Yeah. back in Ohio during the summer, we had what we called 5-day club. Very similar, you might be more familiar with Vacation Bible School. It's a 5-day kids club where children would come during the summer and we'd have a program that would last 2 or 3 hours. Well, instead of having people come to the church, we went to the community. We went into neighborhoods. At one year we had 8 different clubs going at the same time. One of those clubs was in a brand new neighborhood. It was in a small house with a very small yard and a little garage. And we had about 40 kids in this particular club. It was filled with people, filled with kids, and parents were all around watching what was happening. And we were coming up to Thursday. And Thursday was the day that we presented the plan of salvation and invited children to ask Jesus into their life. And as we stood there that night, it was the early evening, and I can remember standing with a few people at the fence, looking in at the yard, seeing these 40 kids playing a game or something, and seeing this big black cloud start to form and start coming closer and closer. And pretty soon that black cloud grew and grew and grew, and we could see rain coming out of it. Then there were flashes of lightning and thunder, and we could see that it was headed right for us. A few of us got together and we said, this is a disaster. If this rains like this, if this storm hits us, these kids are all going to be going home and they will never have heard this plan of salvation, get that opportunity to pray and trust Christ. And we saw this as a spiritual battle. A few of us just went to prayer, praying, God, please save us. This is hopeless unless you do something. And I can remember standing there after that and looking up and seeing the cloud get closer and closer. The sky got almost completely dark. And then all of a sudden, the cloud split in two. It split in two and we watched it go around us. And then it got back together on the other side and kept going. I ran home and I looked on weather.com to see if the radar reflected that. And sure enough, the big red blob came right towards us. It split in two. And then after it passed the house, it went back together again and went on its merry way. So you see, I saw a powerful God. In the midst of a hopeless situation, I saw the power of God. Had it been just a beautiful, gorgeous day with fluffy white clouds all day, I would have never seen the greatness of God. I would have assumed it. But now I saw it in action. Are you looking for the brilliance of God's hope in your life? Are you facing a hopeless, discomforting situation? Saying, I got to see the hope of God. My friend, He is working everything in your life to help you focus on His eternal and powerful hope. Do you hear that? Everything going on in your life right now is helping you focus in upon and have faith in and draw deeper on His eternal, life-giving hope. I can almost hear some of you saying, well, if God spoke to me like He spoke to Jonah, I surely would listen to Him. I would drink in those words of hope. But you see, we have a greater advantage than Jonah ever had. For you see, the greatness of God's hope is best seen in the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about that. Consider the reality that Jonah didn't have any clue what God was about to do. And we today have the ability to look upon the Lord Jesus Christ as God's greatest gift of hope ever given to the world. I love the way the writer of Hebrews says it. In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways. He spoke through Moses and Ezekiel and Jeremiah and Isaiah and Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, all those great prophets God used in wonderful, powerful ways. But in these last days, He has spoken to us by His Son. The most personal way God could communicate to us through His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things, and through whom He made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory. He is the shining hope of God in this world. He's the exact representation of God, sustaining all things by his powerful word. Did you realize that it's God's word? It's Jesus' word that holds the world together. In the midst of this pandemic, if it wasn't for Jesus, this world would come completely unglued. He's holding it together. As much as it feels like it's out of control, he holds it together. And after he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. Not only does he bring hope to the universe, he brings hope to our souls. Hope of eternal life because of what he did and laying down his life to pay the penalty for our sins so that we could be reconciled, made right with God. That's the ultimate hopeless situation, our relationship with God. And only because of Jesus Christ doing that, coming in and taking on this very discomfortable area of this world and actually going and dying on the cross in absolute discomfort, coming into our hopeless situation, he brought life. He brought the hope of eternal life with him. You see, God intervened in our world. He's already taken the step, and the darkest day that this world has ever seen, a day called Calvary, a day called we call Good Friday. It's a day when his hope shined best. So whatever discomfort or hopelessness that you're facing right now, it's nothing in light of what God has spoken and done through Jesus Christ. It's all resolved in Jesus. God's interruptions oftentimes are annoyances. They're inconvenient. But if we would see them not as interruptions, but as interventions. God intervening in our lives to show us his greatness and his power and glory. How different we would understand life. How different we would understand him. How much access to our souls. How much more access to our souls he would have. Gloria Gaither, a songwriter in the United States, was quoted by someone saying this one time: God is always in my interruptions, but he's seldom in my plans. I think that's a pretty good statement. I think it's pretty accurate to say that the interruptions in our lives are really God's interventions. And as much as I would like to think that he is all about my plans, he's more interested in having me know him. Fall in love more and more with him. Know him in a deeper, more passionate, more intimate way. And so he brings interventions into my life. They sometimes feel horrible. But in reality, they're the best thing God could ever do for us. I want to conclude with a story about a man by the name of Robert Matthews. And I'm going to read his own words of the story that he conveys about God's interventions in his life. A few weeks before September 11th, 2001, my wife and I found out that we were going to have our first child. She planned a trip out to California to visit her sister. And on the way to the airport, we prayed that God would grant my wife a safe trip and be with her. Shortly after I said amen, we both heard a loud pop and the car shook violently. We'd blown out a tire. Well, I replaced the tire as quickly as I could, but we still missed her flight. Both of us were very upset as we drove home. I received a call from my father, who was a retired New York Fire Department worker, and he asked what flight number my wife was on. I explained that my wife had missed that flight, and it was then that my father informed me that her flight was the one that crashed into the South Tower of the World Trade Center. I was too shocked to speak. But my father had more news for me. He was going to go in and help. This is not something I can just sit back for. I have to go and do something. I was concerned for his safety, of course, but more because he had never given his life to Christ. After a brief debate, I knew his mind was made up. Before he got off the phone, he said to me, "Just take good care of my grandchild." Those were the last words I ever heard my father say. He died while helping in the rescue effort. The joy that my prayer of safety for my wife had been answered quickly became anger. I was angry at God and my father. I was angry at myself. I had gone for nearly 2 years blaming God for taking my father away. My son would never know his grandfather. My father had never accepted Christ, and I never got to say goodbye to him. But then something happened. About 2 months ago, I was sitting at home with my wife and my son when there was a knock at the door. I looked at my wife and I could tell that she wasn't expecting anyone. I went to the door and opened it to find a couple with a small child. The man looked at me and asked if my father's name was Jake Matthews. I told him it was. Well, he quickly grabbed my hand and said, "I never got the chance to meet your father, but it is an honor to meet you, his son." He explained to me then that his wife had worked at the World Trade Center and she had been caught inside after the attack. She was pregnant and had been caught under the debris. He then explained that my father had been one to find his wife and free her. My eyes welled up with tears as I thought of my father giving his life for people like this. He then said, "There's something else that you need to know." His wife then told me that as my father worked to free her, she talked to him about Jesus Christ, and she led him to saving faith in Christ. Matthew's right, I began sobbing at the news. Now I know that when I get to heaven, my father will be standing right there beside Jesus to welcome me, and that his family will be able to thank him themselves. When their baby was born, they named him Jacob Matthew, in honor of the man who gave his life so that a mother and baby could live. Jacob Matthew gave his life to save that mother and child. And my friend, Jesus gave his life to save you. All of our hope, all of our comfort is found in the person of Jesus Christ. And today, if you don't know him as your Savior, I beg you to turn to him, to turn away from your sin, to turn away from yourself, and to embrace all that God is for you. If you do know him and you're struggling through discomfort and you're struggling through hopelessness, turn and fix your eyes upon Jesus, the author, the one who began you on this faith journey, and the one who will carry you through to the end of your faith journey. My friends, looking to Jesus is the way that we find our comfort and our hope in the midst of trying circumstances. God has shown us the grandeur of his love and peace and greatness in the person of Jesus. Accept him now. Make him the king of your heart. Allow him right now, in these moments as we sing, to fill your heart and mind with his light, with his comfort, with his hope. And to him be all the praise and glory. Let's join together and sing.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my every are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my
Krista and Ryan, thank you so much for leading us in our musical worship today. I can't tell you how many notes and emails and comments that I've gotten from people expressing appreciation to all of the worship leaders for their ministry to the BIF family during this time. So thank you once again for leading us into the heart of worship. Two things I want to remind you about. One is the Benevolent Fund. We sent out an email on Friday to you about the need that we have in our Benevolent Fund, and we want to encourage you to go to one of those red payment machines and use the formula that we have provided for you for how you can contribute to BIF. But what we're doing is over Tuesday and Wednesday of this next week, all funds that come into BIF through those red cash machines, they will be assigned directly to the Benevolence Team so that they can use those to help people who are in emergency financial need within the church. So thank you for opening up your heart and opening up your wallet and going there and being a part of God's ministry to God's people. The other thing is the prayer room. We've been meeting there after the service now for several weeks, and it's a wonderful time where we just have this sense of God's presence, and we're connecting with God and with one another. It's a wonderful place where we can realize the truth of what we preached about today, the comfort of God and the hope of God. There's nothing like praying with God's people together before the face of God to know the extent of God's peace and joy, His comfort, and His hope in our hearts and our lives. So join us, click on that link, and come and just soak in the goodness of God through that prayer time. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit within you. Go and be people of hope, people of joy, people of peace, people of comfort. In a world that is torn apart, that is in chaos, oh, may you be a source of comfort and hope, of God's hope, of God's peace, of God's comfort to all that you meet this week. And God's people said, amen. Go in His hope and His peace.